love to praise the name of the Lord. This is the time set that we go before the Lord in prayer.
Yes.
We would like for everybody in the temple to stand, those that can stand. Hallelujah to God. Hallelujah. Oh, gracious Father, we come before you right now, God, in the name of Jesus. Lord God, we thank you for this 10th year anniversary. We thank you for the honorees, District Elder Benjamin Jones and First Lady Jones. God, what you have done in their life. God, we just thank you for this night. This is our first night of anniversary. And Lord God, we just need you to show up. We need you, God, that you will walk up and down the pews, in between the pews, oh God. Lord God, we want to see your glory in the temple tonight. God, we ask you, God, to touch them that need a touch on tonight. God, heal them that need healing, Lord. Bring deliverance, Lord God. Bring a backslider back in, God. Save somebody, God, that needs to be saved. God, we ask you, God, to move by your power and in your spirit, that you would show up and show out, God. That you would get in the hands of the musician, Lord. That you would get in the mouth of the singers, Lord. That you would even pray, bless the praise dancers, Lord. God, we ask you, Lord God, to have your way on tonight. Speak, Holy Ghost. Speak from heaven. God, we ask you, Lord God, to bless the man of God as he brings forth the word. Have thy way, God, in this house. We welcome you, Holy Ghost. We welcome you, Holy Ghost. Take charge of this service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Praise the Lord. I will be reading from Psalms 118, verses 21 through 27. I will praise thee, for thou hast heard me and art become my salvation. The stone which the builders refused has become the headstone of the corner. This is the Lord's doing.
Yes.
It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day which the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Save now, I beseech thee, O Lord. O Lord, I beseech thee, send now prosperity. Blessed be he that cometh in the name of the Lord. We have blessed you out of the house of the Lord. God is the Lord, which have showed us light, bind the sacrifice with cords, even unto the horns of the altar. Again, this is the Lord's doing,
yes,
and it is marvelous in his eyes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. It's not a greeting, it's a command. Praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, somebody, lift up a praise in this place. We came to celebrate. God has seen fit for us to be here 10 years. So we came with a praise on our list, and we just want you to celebrate with us. Come on, lift your hands and somebody shout hallelujah. Now we're gonna sing this song, everybody knows it. And since praise and worship is participatory, that means that I expect you to sing with us. Can you sing with us this evening? All right, hallelujah. The song says, the splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice. Trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, see how great is our God. Age to age he stands.
Thank you, Lord.
Time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. He's a Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and
Then sings my soul, oh my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou. Say, how great, sing it, say,
how great, yeah, is our God.
Sing with me.
Sing me how great.
I love to sing your praise.
Our God.
Oh, see one day.
How great.
How great.
How great. Is our God.
Oh, listen, repeat after me. Repeat after me. Say, say,
your name is above all.
How great is our God. Sing it. No music. Sing.
Sing with me.
No music. Let your voice be the instrument. All the
see how great.
How great.
How great
is our God.
Is our God.
Say it again. How great. How great.
How great.
Do you love him today?
Is our God.
Somebody just lift your hands.
Sing with me.
And close your eyes when you see him. Think of his goodness to you.
Oh, see how great.
How great.
How great.
How great.
Is our God.
Come in softly. Say it one more time. How great.
How great.
How great. Thank you, Lord.
Is our God.
You saved my soul one day.
How great.
And I thank you, Lord.
Oh, we'll
see.
How great.
How great.
How great.
The name of the Lord in this place.
Hallelujah. 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 How many of you know that for every mountain that God has brought us over, for every trial and every valley that he's seen us through, for every mountain and every blessing, hallelujah, for this we will give you praise, God. Hallelujah.
open your mouth and give God praise. Come open your mouth and give God praise. I know that's for every mountain. He brought you through some mountains. It was God who took you over that mountain. When you didn't know how you was gonna make it over, it was God that did it for you. Come on, what's it for every mountain? Y'all come to lift them up on this evening. Do we mind just going old school for just 1 second? What do you want the Lord to say? What do you want the Lord to say?
Him say, well,
Him say. We'll be singing. We'll be shouting. Feel safe. Come on, put your hands together. We'll be singing. We'll be shouting. We'll be singing, we'll be shouting, we'll be singing, we'll be shouting, we'll be singing, we'll be shouting, we'll be singing, we'll be shouting. Come on, put your hands together. Hearing them say that. Well done. Him say, well done. Him say,
well done.
Him say,
well done.
Him say,
well done.
Can you imagine hearing them say, well done, thy good and faithful servant. Thank you very much. I don't know about you, but I come expecting a high time in the Lord. This is the day which the Lord has made. Say, we shall rejoice and be glad in it. At this time, we're going to have Sister Talina come up with our welcome address.
Praise the Lord, everyone. Praise the Lord, everyone. I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. We would like to welcome you to Nehemiah's Temple 10th anniversary. Hallelujah. We would like for you to get into this celebratory moment with us. If you want to clap your hands, that's okay to do. If you want to stomp your feet, that is okay to do as well. However, if this is your first time here, we ask that you do not let it be your last time here. Amen. And again, welcome and God bless you.
Amen. A District Elder Thompson of the Mind coming up. Amen. And just responding to that wonderful welcome address.
Praise Jesus, everybody. Come on, you can do better than that. I didn't say Thompson. I said, praise Jesus. Somebody shout hallelujah. Say it again. Hallelujah. God bless you. Thank you that invitation. And we've been blessed. The Mona Lisa and I have just come in. Some of our congregants are here, Bible Fellowship, but we want to say we always feel welcome. This is like home here. But I'm just looking at what God is doing. Great God from heaven. Lord have mercy. 10 years. On behalf of Bible Fellowship, and there are others here that perhaps this is your first time, just wave your hand, just wave your hand if it's your first time. Look out, wave your hand. We want to say we feel welcome. Tell them we feel welcome. Thank you for the invitation, and we are very welcome. Thank you.
God is great, and he's greatly to be praised. If y'all don't mind, we're going to have another selection by Minister David Reed. Amen. Put your hands together as he continues to usher the Spirit of the Lord into this house. How many of y'all know where the Spirit of the Lord is? There is liberty. How many of y'all feel liberated tonight? How many of y'all feel liberated tonight? Hallelujah.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall. Lord, you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won. Lord, you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me yet. I see you move. You move the mountain. And I believe that you do it again. You made a way out of no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. I've seen you move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. I've seen and I believe I see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way. And I believe I see you do it again. I've seen you move. You move the mountain. And I believe I see you do it again. You made promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. Your promise still stands. This is my confidence. You never fail me. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. Still in your hands, this is my confidence. You never fail me. Yet.
Come on, put your hands together and give God some praise. Amen. Our young adult praise team is getting ready to come up. Amen. Put your hands together and receive them. Come on, give God some praise for this ministry.
Yes, he's been good. just
open your mouth.
To say God's been good is an understatement. Y'all feeling me? So if you crazy like me, look at your neighbor and say, excuse me. Excuse my language. But the word good ain't good enough. So allow me to say it this way. God's been so to me. Yeah!
Come open your mouth. He's been good to you too. I believe he's been good to you. Open your mouth and give him praise. Come on, he's been good to you. He woke you up this morning. When that car almost hit you, or maybe it did hit you, but God was good to you. He said, rejoice with them that rejoice. We ought to rejoice with them. Open your mouth and give them praise. I challenge you to reach way down. Open your mouth and give God some praise. But look, only if he's been good to you. If he hasn't been good, don't praise him. But if he's been good, open your mouth and bless him. I've told some of y'all a couple of years ago, I had an allergic reaction to the eye dye. My eyes started dilating. But God was good. How many of y'all almost died before? Maybe you don't have an almost died kind of pray. Hallelujah. Come on, give them praise. Open your mouth and praise him. The psalmist said, oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Come on, he deserves your praise. He deserves your praise. He deserves your praise. Some of y'all promise God, if you bring me through this, I'll praise you. God brought you through, you owe him praise. Come on, we set the atmosphere. We set the atmosphere. We're going to break in a new carpet tonight. We're going to break in a new carpet by giving God a new praise. Come on, he gave us the victory. We owe him praise. You know, we used to say, when I think of the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me. My soul and our souls are crying out. Come on, it's all right to praise him. Now listen. I'm a pretty good salesperson, but I shouldn't have to sell you on praising Jesus. I'm pretty good at swaying people, but I shouldn't have to sway you to give God praise. You are obligated to give God praise. He said, let everything that have breath. Now, I'm not going to say that. I just want those who have breath that God's been good to give them praise. No pressure. No pressure praise. This is a no pressure praise. No pressure. Give them a no pressure praise. A just because praise. Come on, just because. Just because. Just because. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. This time we're going to have remarks from District Elder Farah. We're going to have some remarks from him. We're glad he's here with us. This old school preacher, when you come in a day early. Now this is our speaker for tomorrow, but he's here tonight. That's old school preacher.
Praise the Lord, everybody. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. My testimony remains the same. If it had not been for the Lord who was on my side, I would have been consumed a long time ago. Certainly giving honor to your pastor, the angel of this house, Dr. Jones and Lady Jones. Certainly to my pastor, our presiding bishop, Bishop Lambert Wade Gates Sr., and to all of these preachers and pastors that are here. We greet you in the name of the Lord. I'm here early because I'm the glorified Uber driver. My girls are with me, Lauren and Monique, they're with me tonight and really for this weekend. Our youngest is turning 17 tomorrow, and she wanted to spend it in Michigan. So I was a good reason. I was a good reason to get in the car to come. But certainly we're excited about what God has done here at Nehemiah's Temple. This is the Lord's doing. And it is marvelous in our eyes. God bless you.
We're going to get another selection from the Nehemiah's Temple Adult Praise Team. Put your hands together.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. How many know he deserves our best praise? Hallelujah. No matter how I may be feeling in my body, hallelujah, you deserve everything I have to give, Lord. Hallelujah. Anybody that know that song, we just want to give God our best praise. Hallelujah, because he's due to it. Hallelujah. My hallelujah belongs to you. Oh, Lord. My hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you. You deserve it.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Everything I owe you, Lord, it belongs to you. Hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you.
Anybody in here that's sincere about your praise, let's praise them together.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Everything I have, Lord, my life, my health, and my strength.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
For waking me up this morning to see a brand new day. Hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Lord, I just thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs.
Deserves it. You know that he deserves it. Thank you, praise team. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, we thank God for his goodness and his kindness. I am so grateful to have you here tonight with us, and I'm grateful for what the Lord has been doing in this ministry. This is our third location. This is the second one we purchased. It's the second one that we actually purchased, amen. And you know, we're just elated and pleased and honored that God would favor us so, and we appreciate everything that he does for us, and all we wanna do is right. We just wanna do right. That's all, we just wanna do right. Not trying to be the biggest dog in the playground. Not trying to be, you know, anything spectacular. Just want to do the will of God. Want to see souls get saved. Want to see lives restored. Want to see hearts be made right. Yes, yes. Want to love somebody. Anybody want to love somebody? I want to love somebody. Yes, yes. So we're grateful for everything that he has done for us. And somebody asked me earlier, when we said it had been 10 years, and they said that did it seem like it, and you know, some days it seemed like it, but most of the time it's, you know, been a marvel how quick it had passed, except when I look in the mirror and I see all that gray hair, I see all that gray hair and how much I have changed, but you know, we, like I said, we are very grateful to God. I thank God for the Nehemiah's Temple Church family, just some awesome people. We got some awesome saints at Nehemiah's Temple, I tell you that. Yes, hallelujah. Make you glad to be their pastor. Hallelujah. Yeah, even when they give you a hard time. Because they not hard to pastor. Thank God for all of them. Thank God for all of them. And I'm so grateful tonight for those that are here with us. Our district elder, the district elder of this church, District Elder Thompson, who I know you've already heard from. Amen. Thank God for him being here. And his lovely wife, yes, Lady Thompson. God bless you. Did you get a chance to praise the Lord yet? Come on, praise the Lord. Come on, praise the Lord. Amen. God bless you, Lady Thompson. Her husband calls her the Mona Lisa. I told him one day, is she a work of art? He looked at me and said, that's pretty good. I'm going to use that. So I thank God for him. And you've heard from District Elder Fair. Amen. That's our friend. And amen. We're so glad for him. And amen, coming in tonight, so grateful for him coming in. But also, you know, when we started this ministry, when we went out, you know that we were a part of the Greater Apostolic Faith Temple Church. When many of them are here tonight, thank God for Greater Apostolic Faith Temple that's here. And still, I consider them our mother church, because I thought about it the other day when I went up to the office and met with Bishop Gates and said the Lord was sending me out. And Bishop Gates concurred, and wasn't that he was trying to run me out. He didn't say, oh, good, about time he sent you somewhere. You know, it wasn't that, you know. He could see that God was doing something. And he relented and sent us out with great support, But I remember standing on that pulpit and with my wife, and she was crying as we were telling people we were about to go. Oh, I was the one crying. Yeah, because we had been there 15 years and had worked there with Bishop Smith and then with Bishop Gates, and then to be telling them that the Lord was sending us out, and the tears were flowing, we didn't really have any place to go. The only thing we had at that time was a post office box. And it had a name, Nehemiah's Temple of the Apostolic Faith. Post office box 27. That's all we had. But the Lord knew that there would be much more coming. He told me, in due time. And so I'm so grateful that the Great Apostolic Faith Temple in particular, Pastor Bishop Gates, has been supportive of this ministry since its inception, since we started, and he have always tried to encourage us and to make sure that we were doing well, and I appreciate him for that. And so at this time, I'm actually going to turn the service into his hand. I want to present our presiding prelate and the pastor of Great Apostolic Faith Temple and Mount Zion in Indianapolis. Let us stand and receive Bishop Lambert Wade Gates, Sr.
You certainly may be seated, and let's put our hands together for Jesus. Come on. We bless the Lord tonight, and you don't have to touch your neighbor, but if you love Jesus, just find a neighbor somewhere and tell him Jesus is the best thing that ever happened to me. And then I dare you to celebrate Jesus another time. Oh, my. Hallelujah. Amen. I'm looking around this sanctuary, and I don't know about you, but I'm going to say what the psalmist said, and that this is the Lord's doing. And he said it's marvelous in our eyes, and we're just rejoicing in the blessings of the Lord. And it's nice when God allows his people to progress and to move forward. And it's even nicer when you can be a part of what God is doing. Amen. And so we are elated for that tonight. Beautiful grounds, beautiful church, beautiful sanctuary, beautiful office, and even a meditation room upstairs. I went in there and looked. I said, I don't have no meditation room. And then I got a meditation room with an easy chair. Oh my, amen. But everything is so lovely. But it didn't happen by accident. It happened because God had a man who dedicated himself to the cause of the Lord, was yielded, and wanted to be used by God. And God has used him. And during these 10 years, it's been a decade, I didn't realize that, but they have progressively moved forward in ministry. Church's progress. And so we don't want to just pretend it happened by accident. Bible says the elders that rule well, they're worthy of double honor. And he hadn't been selfish in this ministry, labored, worked. I think he's still working. But I'm hoping y'all gonna stop him from working soon. Hello. Amen. So he can give himself fully to the assignment that's on his life. And I'm being deliberate with my remarks right now, because I just want you to simmer and think, and want you to help me right now show some love to this wonderful man of God, District Elder, Pastor, Dr. Benjamin Jones. Let's salute him tonight. Very special way. Amen. I'm here tonight, and I'm happy to be here tonight. Not here because my arm was twisted, but I am here because I'm compelled to be here. To be a partner in this service. A lot of other things I could say tonight, but I'm gonna save that for Saturday, since I'll be back if the Lord says the same. Just tonight, I do wanna say that he didn't do it by himself. Amen. He would tell you that God first, but then there was somebody at his side. Amen. That has been a force. I think they celebrate 40 years. Was it? Oh, 39 years the other day. Amen. And but she's a wonderful first lady. Would you salute the first lady, Lady Shayla Jones? Love her and thank God for her. Beautiful life. I just needed to do one thing in the new church. I had a special presentation for her tonight. Now, all of y'all won't understand this, but it's a bottle of Fiji water with ribbons on it. And Lady Shayla, on behalf of myself and Lady Nancy Gates and the Great Apostolic Faith Temple Church family, your home church, I want to present you this beautiful bottle of water in Jesus' name. Now, I'll let District Elder Jones tell you about that, but that's a little inside laugh that he and I have. Do you have water here? You got a lot of water now? All right, I want to see it after church. I'm going to tell it tonight. I was at last time, or the time before last, when I came, she wanted some water. And in the office, I don't think, were we down to one bottle or what? But he didn't want her to take his water. Did y'all hear what I said? He loved her, but he didn't want to give up that water. And so I said, I want to show him a more excellent way. But she gets water. So that's been our little laugh inside out. I always ask her when I see, is he giving you water? But he's doing better now. Is that right? So I don't need to bring no more. I don't have to bring no more. Let's thank God the first lady got water now. We are delighted to be here tonight. I'm so happy for this very fine choir that has come with us. Let's say amen from Great Apostolic Faith Temple. They're going to be blessing us. Thank God for our minister of worship, Elder Noel Hall. Let's thank God for him, the musicians, our band. And we salute this church. District Elder Thompson, honorable man of God. Let's thank God for him. He's the man that keeps us right in the organization. keeps us on the right path and keep that tax man away from us. And we love him and appreciate him. My son in the gospel is here tonight, District Elder Daryl Fair. And I want him to teach me. I feel like I'm not a preacher now. I'm looking at him and he's looking all official, and I start to call him Pope Pius. I dressed up here, my mama said a wrapped around collar and all of that. We thank God for him. The maestro and an honorable man of God. He don't know it. I peek in on him on the internet sometime, see what he's doing over here, but he's a great man of God. Dear friend, come up together. Pastor Nathaniel Edwards, let's thank God for him tonight. To Pastor Hill, amen. That's another little laugh. We thank God that he's here tonight. In Jesus' name, great man of God. All the ministers, I better call, let me call Sister Campbell's name. That's my buddy, that's why I'm doing that. But she's an honorable woman of God. Let's praise God for her. Great woman of God, one of the associate pastors of this church. Everybody else who is somebody at Nehemiah's Temple and Great Apostolic and from Pontiac and from wherever you are, we're happy you are here tonight in Jesus' name. Now, we want to move expeditiously. Would you join hands with your neighbor and bow your head with us in prayer? Father, we bless you tonight and we give you glory and honor. We revel, Lord, in what you have done. We give you the praise and the glory. And we thank you, Lord, for tonight we see advancement in your kingdom. You've raised Nehemiah's temple for a time such as this. And we thank you, Lord, for planting them in this part of your vineyard to be a force for your glory and for your name's sake. And our prayer, Lord, is that you'll continue to bless them, that you'll bless all your people, that you bless us even now as we prepare to give. We need the Holy Spirit to prepare our hearts and minds that we can sow into this good ground. And Lord, we thank you in advance for a liberal spirit. And we thank you in advance, Lord, for what you will do even as a result of what we do for you. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. The Lord bless you. Come on, praise God one more time. Lord bless you. Now I don't want to be long tonight, and Pastor was so kind, he turned the service over into my hands, and so that means I'm in charge because he has given me that permission and latitude. And so I need your help tonight. I came to be a blessing. I'm here tonight, back again to go up north tomorrow night, back here Saturday for the official dedication of this church. But when we were first booked to come, I don't think this church was on the radar at that time. This came up in the aftermath of I originally being on program, and of course he's asked us to come as his pastor and as a presiding bishop and the council bishop to officiate at the dedication on Saturday. But I didn't want to renege on tonight. We talked, we had me on program twice. I told him he didn't have to change a thing. We'd come with the choir tonight and then we would return on Saturday, because this is a special week and a special time. I think this is the first night of this weekend of celebration. And I want everybody to look at somebody. If you trust me enough, you know I'm not gonna tell you to say nothing bad. So just look at somebody as we speak colloquially and tell them, you know the deal. All right then. Now, new churches need some money. Can I get a witness? When you move to a new edifice. I remember in Indianapolis when we moved over on 38th Street, After we got there, we needed some money bad. When we built the new sanctuary there, we were on E. I thought I was crazy. And I think a lot of my board, a lot of other folk thought I was crazy. But when you honor God in faith, He will bless you. But let me tell you how the Lord blesses you. The Lord blesses you through others. Amen. I remember when I was tussling, the Lord put me on somebody's heart. Matter of fact, I'm not going to go into details. The pastor of the church where this young man leads right now. And I was scuffling trying to get that edifice up. And I felt all by myself. Didn't look like nobody was going to help me. And I preached about feeling sorry for yourself Sunday. What was that word I said? Huh? Victim. I had a victim mentality. And but somehow God got me through. But then the Lord put me on the heart of the pastor, founding pastor of the church with Israel Affairs, Bishop Halton, dear friend of mine. And he called my church behind my back and came to town and let the officers know he was coming. Came in and took over my church on Sunday morning. We still had two morning services at that time. And he got up and said, the Lord showed me to him. And my son, my eldest son, came to him. He asked him how his father was doing. And he said, my daddy needs some help. And he came and helped me, brought a big check for the church, and then gave another check and told me and my wife, go take a vacation. You know, everybody needs some friends like that. Can I get a witness? And so when you're stretching out, you need friends. And all of our day, all of our time will come. Now, we're here tonight. I'm coming back Saturday. We're going to do a little bit tonight. Hoping a lot of pastors will be here Saturday, because every pastor have their day. Y'all ain't going to say nothing, but I'm going to say something. And it's important that we rally to one another. Moreover, it's important that the people of God rally together. And where I pastor both churches, I need money. Did y'all hear what I said? I ain't got too much pride to tell y'all I need money. Those are some big buildings, some big gas, and they're getting old and they need repair. I'm gonna come closer to y'all because y'all act like y'all don't wanna talk. It takes money. Anybody remember Reverend Otis back in the day? He was on the radio. I'm not him, but he said, I need some money, honey. That was Reverend Otis. I'm not going to pull a Reverend Otis on you. But tonight, I am going to ask you to consider what God has put in the heart of this man of God to do. And he stepped out in faith when he left Great Apostolic. He didn't leave in a bad way. I said, I'm not going to go deep into that. But he left on good terms. And that's why I can be here tonight and support him without reservation and unabashedly. Because he's an honorable man and he's a faith man. And so tonight, I want to ask you to help me help him. Can we do that tonight? And how are we going to help him? By helping the church that he pastors. And so tonight we need some givers. I'm hoping you've prayed about it. And I'm hoping that you have determined within yourself. Many of you perhaps won't be here Saturday. I will, but you'll do something that is sacrificial. And sacrificial giving actually means that I'm going to give up something. That's what sacrificial giving is. It's not a sacrifice if I don't feel a little pinch. And so we're going to ask you to do that tonight. Now, we brought a check with us tonight from Great Apostolic. I'm coming back. This check is for $200. And we're not doing anything to be recognized. But I'm doing it. We want you to hear what we're doing because we want you to be inspired. We want to provoke one another to good works. And we want to know that we got a good offering tonight. Now, Lady Gates and I, and I'm calling her name because whatever I have belonged to her. Amen. Now, y'all ain't got to tell, don't tell her everything I gave that belonged to her. Y'all, it's because some of y'all can't keep nothing. I'm looking at you. Amen. But I'm going to sow $300 so that you take it right on. 300, yes, ma'am. Not 3,000, but 300. All right. I'm sorry. So that's 500 that we're going to start with. I want to see, let me see, because we got to do this real quick. But we want to be, everybody want to be a blessing. Say, I want to be a blessing. All right. Now, let's update that. Everybody want to be a blessing tonight. Say, I want to be a blessing tonight. All right. Well, we can do this. I need tonight. Disregarder didn't give me a goal or anything, but I need tonight, not because we're coming back Saturday, and I'm telling y'all I'm coming looking for some money Saturday. But tonight, we'll go light. It didn't bounce or nothing, did it? Oh, all right. And you would have covered for me if it had bounced, wouldn't you? All right. Yeah. You know, don't mess nobody up in front of the whole. You ever seen folk in the grocery line and they holding up the whole line? So I don't know what's wrong with that car. You know what's wrong with that car. Ain't no money. But don't do that to me in front of the whole church, you know. But thank Lord, I thank you it worked tonight. And All right. So now what I would like to ask, I don't know if it's here or not. I'm going to ask. I need about 15 people so we can move fast that will give $100. I need about 15 people. This is the first night of a celebration. I knew Deacon Smith was getting up. Oh, there go my sister getting up. Amen. Oh, my. Just because we love this man of God. Sir? Oh, the district elder standing with me. He said, I'm giving $300. The pastor say he doing 300, but the pastor, he put me in charge. And you told me upstairs I was still your pastor.
Yeah.
That's what you told me. You got to go sit down. Let us bless you tonight. You've been blessing. Is that all right? We're going to bless you. We know he gives. And sometimes the poor pastor give till he done almost gave out. I'm just telling y'all the truth. Pastors give more, or they're getting all the money. Whatever money they get, they have to give most of it back to make it work. So, but tonight, we want to be a blessing to him. So District Elder gave $300. Who else can sow a $100 seed tonight? Thank you. I see some hands. I know y'all don't want to stand, but I need you to stand. I'm trying these contacts again, and I can't see good. They got to work in. So everybody that's doing it, would y'all stand one more time? I've been trying contacts because I tear my glasses up preaching, but I'm probably have to go back to them if they don't get better. So let's see, 2, 4, 6. Several of my officers and members are standing tonight. I'm so happy about that. I see you, Rosa. We'll excuse you because of your age. I ain't going to bother you. You stay seated. Okay. You got me too. All right. So 2, 4, 6, 8, 9. And you all may be seated. Thank you, Deacon Matthews. Did I get somebody else? Two people went over there. That's 11. See, I knew if I talk nice about you, you give some money. That's 12. Amen. I need just two more tonight. I'm not going to work you hard. I just need two more tonight that will step out in faith with me and sow $100 seed. Thank you, sir. Amen. I need one more tonight that'll step out in faith. Can I get one more? Just tonight for this special opening night of this great celebration. Can I get one more person that'll sow that $100 seed? Huh? Yes, we called you. District Elder's giving it. Thank you, sir. Can I get one more? Somebody weigh me down. Thank you. This is Brother Brown. He took me around when I was a kid. Still helping me out. Amen. made sure I got to the youth fellowship and things. All right, now, you all think I'm gonna go all night, I'm not. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to look at somebody lovingly, Holy Ghost lovingly, and say, neighbor, this is a special night. Say, Bishop is asking you if you would consider sowing a $20 seed or come as close as you can. Everybody that will attempt to do that, either 20 or as close as my ability will allow, could be 1999, could be 15, could be 10, but I'm gonna dig. If I can get that 20, I'm gonna get that 20. If I can't get that 20, I'm gonna find as close as I can and sacrifice that tonight. If you'll do it again, would you shout glory?
Glory.
All right, now here's what I want us to do. I'm gonna ask everybody to stand. We have already prayed. What I'd like you to do is follow the directions of the ushers. God. He loves that. Oh, they put this one on. That one, the battery's out. Yeah, he loveth a cheerful giver. And so just come as the ushers bring you around. We're going to ask the musicians. And y'all play us some happy music now. So the saints can smile. Amen. Come on down.
Oh, yeah. Anybody blessed in the city? Are you blessed in the field? Yeah. Let me hear you say, bless, 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 bless. Say, bless, 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 bless. I'm blessed. You're blessed. We're blessed. Everybody blessed. Everybody blessed. Say, bless.
better we are. Yeah.
They keep turning my mic off. Is this one all right? I'm about to take it personal every time. Every mic I agree. The Lord bless you. Would you look at your neighbor and say, thank you so much. And God be with you. We appreciate you for your liberality from the bottom of our hearts. And I know that District Elder Jones and Lady Shayla and this church family appreciates others coming to say we love you. We love you. Hello. We love you, and we're with you in what God is doing. Now, we're going to move forward with this service tonight. Again, it's been put in my hands, and I want to thank Great Apostolic Faith Temple. Those members, they didn't have to come. I asked them to come. They came. And so would y'all love on my church? Amen. Appreciate you. Appreciate you. Those officers that came and this choir, they're going to minister tonight because we know this is a long week. They're going to just bring one selection this evening because we want to be expeditious. Many have to get up and go to work in the morning. Now, we're going to put the rest of this service on autopilot. After this choir has come, we're going to go into the word of the Lord. Amen. And I'm going to be back here Saturday, and I'm going to be ministering Saturday, and I understand officiate in that ceremony. And because I'm in charge, I ain't going to preach tonight. I'm getting a little older, and I done got some sense. And I was going to work, but since my son won't show up early, he gonna preach early. And he gonna preach, he young. He gonna preach tonight, and then he gonna preach again tomorrow night. And he gonna be just fine. Amen. How many know he's a great preacher? And he is gonna bring the word tonight. I knew the Lord was gonna honor my faith. I'm gonna tell you how my faith worked. I left my change of clothes in the trunk, in the car, and God has smiled on me, and I'm so glad. So the Lord bless you. We're going to be praying for District Elder Fair. Amen. Amen. This wonderful choir is coming now. Let's receive them. Would y'all act like y'all glad my choir is here? Love y'all. Come on.
Tonight, if you can stretch and join hands with someone. Father, we do thank you for your loving kindness and your tender mercy toward us. We thank you once again for this church and the decade of faithfulness that you have extended to this pastor and this congregation. Lord, we've come to celebrate. We've come to magnify you and give you all the glory and the praise. Now, Lord, speak to us. We have come, Lord, to celebrate, but in this moment, we're asking that you would speak to us until our thoughts change. Speak to us until we have better choices in our lives. Strengthen us even now. We need you. We depend upon you even now. And Lord, we'll give you the praise, the glory, and the honor. Your word says, Lord, that you can send a word and it heals. And so, Lord, we thank you for healing tonight. We thank you, Lord, for sending us a word that will help us, that will strengthen us. Save tonight. Work a miracle in someone's life. Lord, we'll give you the praise, the glory, and the honor. In Jesus' name, everybody said amen. Amen. Certainly, once again, we thank God for, again, the angel of this house and to his wife and to this great, great congregation. Our pastor said it right. It didn't happen by accident, and they didn't do it by themselves. But God's been with them, and this congregation has stood with them, and we're just here to celebrate. I am here early because I wanted to be here because my pastor was preaching. And when I told my daughters I was coming early, they said, well, we can go with you. And Well, if we don't get it right tonight, give me a chance tomorrow. But you'll find us tonight, and I do solicit your prayers tonight. Exodus chapter number 36 and verse number 7. Exodus chapter number 36 and verse number 7. And it won't be long tonight. Because I didn't plan on being up here. But if you pray, I know God will speak to us tonight. Exodus 36 and verse number 7. If you're there, just declare it out loud. I have the word of God. For the stuff they had was sufficient for all the work to make it. And too much. For the stuff they had was sufficient for all the work to make it and too much. If you would pray with me for a little while around this subject, the right stuff. Just encourage somebody and just tell them, say, you have the right stuff. We have come to celebrate, and certainly we have come to sow and celebrate this weekend to commemorate what God has done and to give a shot in the arm to the congregation, but also just to thank God for the things that he has done. But none of what God does, I believe, since he said, let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, there's been a divine, I believe, partnership that God desires for us to have with him in the kingdom of God. And that when he desires to do something in the earth, you'll discover that he uses people to bring to pass his will in the earth. Somebody's praying, somebody's laying hands, someone is walking out by faith, but there is this partnership that God, he really wants us to be able to walk with him in. The challenge is that oftentimes he does not give us all the details of how the end will occur. He wants us to trust him, like Abraham was instructed to trust him in the book of Genesis, chapter number 12. He says, I want you to get away from your comfort zone, get away from your family, go into a land that I will show you. He had to get up the next day or days after and pack up the tent, pack up the family, without God giving him the direction in the text of which direction to go in. He had to trust that I'm walking by faith and I'm going to end up where God intends for me to end up. District Elder Jones mentioned the fact that when they stepped out in faith, they had a name and a P.O. box. But look what God has done in just 10 years. Come on, it's all right to give God praise for that. Bible teaches us not to despise small beginnings. The Bible teaches us that better is the end of a thing. But I have to trust God at the beginning of a thing. Because sometimes he leads me into areas and leads me into things that make absolutely no sense to me. He leads me into wildernesses. The Bible tells us that when Jesus is tempted of the devil, the Bible says he is led of the Holy Spirit into the wilderness. And there are some things that if God gave us the choice as to whether or not we would do it or not, many of us would say, no, Lord, find somebody else. No, Lord, get somebody else. I would rather do X, Y, and Z. I would rather do this than to do what you have asked me to do. And in many cases, God will allow us a moment of questioning and a moment of prayer. But if you've been around and connected with him for any length of time, you'll discover that he knows exactly how to put us in a position where yes comes out of our spirits. He knows how to orchestrate things. Whether we know how he's going to bring it to pass or not, he knows how to put the pieces together so that at the end of the thing, there's always his glory and there is a blessing if I trust him. The story tonight in Exodus chapter number 36 doesn't actually begin in Exodus 36. It begins with a family going down into Egypt. They go down in Egypt, and while they're there, it's just a small family. But as the family begins to grow over time, the Bible says they begin to seemingly outnumber the Egyptians that are there. Many of us are familiar with the story, and the Bible says that the Egyptians decided that we'll put taskmasters over them. We've got to deal wisely with them, because if an enemy comes in and they decide to fight with our enemy, we may end up going into captivity. So they decided to put taskmasters over them. But the Bible says that the more they were afflicted, the more they grew. Now, many of us, we could find other ways to grow. Why must I be afflicted to grow? Why can't I just pray and grow? Why can't I just fast and grow? For some of us, why can't I just read this Bible verse and grow? But God knows sometimes I have to go through some things. And while I go through those things, I learn how to pray. I learn how to fast. I learn how to praise under pressure. Now, I've discovered, just walking with God for a short amount of time, I've discovered that there's different kinds of praises in the house of God. There's that kind of praise that's real cute, real fancy. The kind of praise that seems like it was practiced. It seems like there's nothing going on in that person's life. But then there's a whole other kind of praise. Almost a frustrated praise, a praise that somebody will clear out that whole row because they are attempting to give God praise, but they're going through something. And while they're going through what they're going through, they have found themselves deciding that while I'm in it, I might as well give God praise. While I'm in it, I might as well give him glory. Why spend another day complaining about what I'm going through when I discovered that I can just give God praise while I'm in it? And some of us have discovered that if I can praise God while I'm in it, I might hasten him bringing me out of it. If I can get to a place in my own mind that instead of spending all night and walking and pacing the floor trying to figure out how things are going to work together, I have come to understand that the Bible says all things work together, but I don't have to know how they work together. I just have to have the faith to understand that it's working together. And my trust says that this is not the first time I've gone through something. This is not the first time I've been afflicted. This is not the first time I've been in a test. And it probably won't be the last time I've gone through a test or a trial. But if I've learned anything, is how to give God praise while I go through whatever it is I go through. And it's a different kind of praise when I'm praising him while I'm in the furnace than I am when I'm on the other side of the furnace. The Bible says that while they were being afflicted, the Bible declares that the more they were afflicted, the more they grew. The Bible says that they devised another plan. They said, well, if we can cut short this generation, if we can begin to kill the male babies, let's kill them while they're on their way out. If we find out that they're a male child, they told the midwives, I want you to kill them. The Bible declares that the midwives, they were wise enough, and they said, well, by the time we get there, the babies are already out. And they passed another law and said, all right, we're gonna start killing these babies. And the Bible says there was a woman who had a son, and the Bible says that she hid her son. The Bible says that while she hid her son, she put him in an ark, the Bible calls it, put him in the river and allowed the sister to go along by that little ark to make sure that nothing happened to that baby. I'm here to tell somebody that God has protected you while you were in what you were in. Because the same river that they put this baby in, it was the same river that they put some of the other babies in, the male children in, and they were drowned to death. And yet God allowed a baby, a male baby, to ride on top of what others drowned in. I'm here to suggest to somebody that you probably shouldn't be here, that you probably should be someplace else. But while you were in what you were in, God protected you while you were in it. And while somebody else completed suicide, you made up in your mind that before I take this bullet, before I take these pills, before I slip my wrist, I'm going to go to church one last time. I'm going to go to the house of prayer one last time. I'm going to give God praise one last time. And that moment that I open up my mouth to give him praise and glory, whatever was on me had to get up off of me. Do I have a witness in here that you found out that I kept my sanity because I had a praise? I kept it together because I had worship. God had his hand on me the whole time. Help me bother your neighbor for just a moment and tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, God had his hand on me the whole time. You got the wrong neighbor. Find you somebody else that look like they've got a testimony and tell them, say, God had his hand on me the entire time. They were attacking me. They were talking about me, but God had his hand on me the whole time. I lost my house. I lost a job. I got pink slipped. I got redlined, but God had his hand on me the entire time. I got sick. I got a bad report from the doctor. I had to go to court, but God had his hand on me the entire time. And when I look back over my life, I discovered that the only reason why I'm here is because of the hand of God. Tap your neighbor and say, the hand of God is on my life. Yes, I should not be here. I should be in a psych ward someplace, but God had his hand on my life. I should have gone crazy. I should have lost my mind. I should have lost my wife. Should have lost my children. Should have lost all my money, but God had his hand on me the entire time. I'm going to try it one more time. Nudge you somebody and tell them, say, God's hand is still on your life. He's still got his hand on you. And I've discovered if God still has his hand on me, it's because God's got plans for me. The Bible declares that this little baby is in this little ark and it goes down the river, bumps into the daughter of Pharaoh. She brings him up out of the water, calls his name Moses, because the Bible says he was drawn out of the water. And the Bible says that he is now raised in the Pharaoh's house. And by the time he gets 40 years old, he has an understanding of the call of God on his life. I got to cut across the field for just a while. The Bible declares that at 40, he understands that I'm supposed to lead. I'm supposed to be a deliverer. I'm supposed to be used by God. But he was a step too soon in his maturity. He knew what he was called to do, but didn't quite know how to get it done. And sometimes that's the problem in the church. It's not that you're not anointed. You just don't know how to get it done. It's not that God didn't call you. You just don't know how to get it done. I'll never forget telling my pastor, I believe I'm called to full-time ministry. I've already quit my job. He said, well, can you get your job back? I said, Pastor, I'm already training my replacement. He said, Daryl, I believe you're going to be in full-time ministry. I believe God's going to bring you into that place. But I'll never forget, he said, but I believe you are a step too soon. And then the next 2.5 years, it was some of the hardest years of my marriage and hardest years in the early stage, the things that happened financially. But I learned something about God that I did not know about him before I went through what I went through. Yes, I understand some things now that I didn't quite understand then. And I wish I had spent more time with my pastor before I made a foolish decision. The Bible declares Moses has an understanding. I'm supposed to lead, and these people are not supposed to be over us. So the Bible declares he saw an Egyptian going after one of the children of Israel, and he took and killed this man and put his body in the ground. And he goes out the very next day thinking that now things are getting ready to change for me, because I have defended my people. I understand that this is what I'm supposed to do. But they didn't look at him as a leader. They said, well, we saw what you did, and you're going to try to kill us now? So the Bible says for the next 40 years of his life, he takes off running. He goes back on the backside of the desert. For the next 40 years of his life, he is a shepherd. But what he does not know is God is training him for the next phase of his life. It doesn't look like training, because he's walking up the hind animals. He's on the backside of the mountain in Midian. He's back there minding his own business, but God is training him, because if you can lead these sheep, then you can lead my children. But I gotta train you so you don't make the same mistake you did 40 years ago. So at the age of 80, he is out there minding his own business, and God set his world world on fire. He set a bush on fire but didn't consume the bush. The Bible declares God begins to speak out of the bush and tell him, Moses, I've called you to go down and talk to Pharaoh. Tell Pharaoh that my children need to go and worship me in the wilderness. Now when you go down there, he's not initially going to let you go, but I'm going to show my hand, and when it's all said and done, he's going to let you go. You know the Bible story. The Bible says that God works his wonders in Egypt. We like to call them plagues, but God called them wonders. In other words, God says, you might think it's bad, but God says, I'm working something out that you don't quite understand. And you might be in something that looks like a plague, but I'm here to tell you, God is working a wonder in your life. You're in something, it looks like it's bad, it looks like it's drying up, it looks like things are going in the wrong direction, but God has sent me here, I have found out, to tell somebody that you are in the middle of a working of God, that God not only has his hand on you, but God has his hand on your situation. Would you tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, God's got his hand on me, and God's got his hand on my situation. The Bible said he begins to work wonders. 10 wonders he works in Egypt, and the Bible declares that while they're making their way to a place where God now can release them into their freedom, he told them before they leave, he said, listen, before you go out, I know you've been in bondage, I know that you've been abused, I know that you've been oppressed, but before you go into the next phase of your life, I'm going to give you favor with the Egyptians. And what I want you to do on your way out of the land of bondage, I want to give you favor, and I want you to spoil the Egyptians. The Bible declares they get gold and silver and brass. They get raiment and clothing and fabric. Why? Because God understands what's getting ready to happen next in their life. Now they're walking out of Egypt, and the Bible says God gave them instruction. Take this gold from the Egyptians, put it on your sons, and put it on your daughters. Put the clothes on. Why? Because when you come out, I don't want you to look like what you've been through. I want you to look like your royalty. I know you've been abused, I know you've been down, but when you come out of this season, I want you to look like you belong to me. You may not even know where you're going, but I need you to step like you're one of my children. I need you to look like you belong to me. Nudge your neighbor and tell them, say, neighbor, I don't look like what I've been through. You may not even like my style, but you should have saw me before God put his hand on me. You may not even like what I look like now, but you should have seen me before the Lord cleaned me up. And while I'm on my way to my next phase of life, I'm walking into my destiny and into my season, looking like a child of God, walking like a child of God, talking like a child of God. The Bible declares they're walking out, and the Bible said he opens up the Red Sea for them to get across. And the last thing that happens, God allows that army from Egypt to chase them down into the Red Sea. And the Bible said he caused the waters to drown them, took the wheels off the chariot. Somebody in here, you feel like the enemy's been chasing you. God just told me to tell you, I'm getting ready to take the wheels off the chariot of the enemy. I know he's riding hard trying to get you, but he can't go where you're going. By the time you make it to the other side, you'll look back and find out the tires are all gone, that they can't chase you into your destiny. They can't chase you into the glory that I have for you. The Bible said they grabbed the tamarind. Miriam and the others, they grabbed the tamarind. They begin to give God the praise and give God the glory. Right around chapter number 25, the Bible declares God speaks to Moses and tells Moses, I want you to collect an offering. Now these are ex-slaves in the wilderness, and God asks of his own children an offering in the wilderness. They don't have a job, they don't have a bank account. How can you collect an offering from people who are ex-slaves? slaves? How can you get an offering from them? Not only did God tell Moses to tell them to give me an offering, but he told them what kind of offering to give. He said, I want gold, silver, and brass. I want blue and red, scarlet. I want badger skin dyed red. I want shittim wood. I want incense for the oil. I want oil for the light. Because everything that God just asked for, he had already blessed them with on their way out. I'm here to tell somebody that you already have the right stuff. I came to tell somebody in Nehemiah's temple that while you are contemplating where God is taking you, and you have taken inventory and you begin to say, I don't have this and I don't have that and I don't have the other, I'm here to tell you, you already have the right stuff. Touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, you've got the right stuff. He said, but pastor, how can you say that? Because God is not going to ask of you things that he has not given you the ability to bring the past. You might as well stop complaining about what he called you to do and understand that he has already given you the right stuff. Y'all still looking at me? Let me try it another way. The right stuff that they had to bring the offering. He asked for the offering in Exodus chapter number 25, but they don't give it until Exodus 36, because in between 25 and 36, they still have to live. And between 25 and 36, he has to give them instructions because they are used to somebody telling them what to do. But in this new phase of victory and freedom and power, I need you to understand how you are supposed to act in this new phase of your life. So let me give you the pattern of the tabernacle. I'm going to give you the pattern of the priesthood. I'm going to give you the pattern of how to make the oil for consecration. The Bible said Moses goes up to talk to God, and while he's up there talking to God, they begin to come to themselves and say, let's make us a god. We don't know what happened to Moses. And they took the gold that they got from the Egyptians that God gave them favor to get. Let me rewind that for a moment. The only reason why they have what they have is because God brought them out and gave them favor. They wouldn't have the gold if God hadn't brought them out. They wouldn't have what they have on their backs if God had not brought them out and then gave them favor. I'm here to remind somebody, it was not your education that brought you where you are. It was not your degrees that got you where you are. There's nothing wrong with education. There's nothing wrong with degrees. Get all of them that God wants you to have. But it was not your money that brought you where you are. It was not your family name that brought you where you are. It was the favor of God on your life. Let me make sure I'm still in the right church. Is there anybody in here that knows that you have a job that you don't have the education for? You've got a promotion that you don't have the experience for. You've got a family that you don't deserve. You've got finances you don't deserve. Lean on your neighbor. I got to quit through here. Lean on your neighbor and say, neighbor, the only reason why I have what I have is because God gave me favor. And the Bible said they took the same gold that God blessed him with. They fashioned a calf and begin to dance around the calf. The Bible declares, God sends Moses down out the mountain. Say, go down there. There's a sound that I hear, but it's not the kind of sound that I'm supposed to be hearing from my children. He goes down. He discovers that they've made an idol out of the gift of favor that God blessed them with. And the Bible says he has to mete out the judgment and then bring correction. But now it's time to get back to the assignment, because there were some that will tell you that if you mess up, that God can't use you in your assignment. He
never changed the assignment. Nehemiah's temple, you're in a new building, but he didn't change the assignment. He brought you from a P.O. box to a whole nother campus, and the assignment is still the same. Shake your neighbor by the hand and say, neighbor, the assignment is still the same. What he told us when we had a P.O. box, he is still thundering in our spirits. Look at somebody and say, neighbor, it's time to get busy with the assignment. What was the assignment, Pastor? He said, build me a sanctuary that I may tamasha, that I may dwell among them. He said, make me a sanctuary. God, you're confusing me. You made the sun, the moon, and the stars, and you're telling us to make you a sanctuary. You said, let the dry ground appear. Let the fruit-bearing trees appear. Let the animals appear. And you said it and you saw it. You said the sun to rule by the day and the moon to rule by night. And you're telling us to make you a sanctuary. If you can make the sun, the moon, and the stars, you can make a sanctuary. He said, I know what I can do, but I need you to understand that when I bring you into assignment, because I brought you from one place into a new place, I need you to understand that you had what was needed for this place when you were still in the old place. Look at somebody and say, neighbor, on our way here, we already had the right stuff. Yeah. Now hear me. The Bible declares, they made the announcement. Tell everybody, I want them to bring the gold, the silver, and the brass. Bring the fabric. Bring the shittim wood. I know you didn't give everything to that calf. I know what you got, because I know what I bless you with. Because there's somebody still here, and you're complaining because you're telling God, I don't know enough Bible. I don't know enough for this. And they can find somebody else for that. But God said, when I brought you out, I gave you the right stuff to get to the next level. When I brought you out, I gave you the right stuff to be able to be successful. When I brought you out, I gave you everything that you needed. And the Bible says that the stuff that they had, it was sufficient. The membership that we have, it's sufficient for the assignment. You say, well, Pastor, what are you saying? That we're not supposed to grow? No, I'm not saying that at all. But the growth will come because of what we already have. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, it's your time now. What you weren't doing before, it's time now to do it. What you were questioning about in the last building, it's time now for you to stretch out now, because you already have the right stuff. Let me close through here. He not only said that you have the right stuff, he said the stuff that you have, it is sufficient. And then he said, too much. Lean on your neighbor and say, neighbor, I just might be too much for you. You got the wrong neighbor. Let me talk on this side for a moment. Shake a neighbor by the hand and say, neighbor, I might be too much for you. Look at somebody. Push the neighbor in front of you and say, oh, neighbor, I might be too much for you, but I'm just right for the assignment that God has placed on my life. Every single woman that's in the sanctuary, you might be too much for the person you might be hanging out with now, but God's got somebody. Touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, I got the right stuff. Now you don't have the gold and you don't have the silver. You may not have the brass, but what did you bring out when you came out of the wilderness? What did you bring out from your last test? What did you get from God from your last circumstance? What did you get from God when you came out of your wilderness? Well, I learned how to pray and I learned how to talk to God. Y'all told me have a little talk with Jesus and tell him all about your struggles. Lean on your neighbor and say, hey neighbor, I don't know about you, but when I came out of my test and when I came out of my trial, I didn't come broken, I didn't come beat down, but I came out with victory. I came out with praise. I came out with worship. I came out with wisdom. I came out with the right stuff. Touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, I got the right stuff. I got it. I got it. It's still in me. I got it. I didn't have it before I went through, but because I went through, I know more about my God than I did before I had the test. I know more about God. We used to sing the song in the church, what do you know about Jesus? And we would simply say that he's all right. But touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, he is more than all right. He's the lily of the valley. He's the bright morning star. He's my comforter. He's my provider. He's my healer. He's my deliverer. He's my company keeper. Yes, yes, yes. He's bread when I'm hungry, water when I'm thirsty. These are the things that I found out about him. And if he's my God, and if he's my Father, I know more about me. So you can't tell me now that I'm not enough. He died for me. He shed blood for me. I got the right stuff. I've been to the water. I've been baptized. I've been filled with the Holy Ghost. I got the right stuff. Nehemiah's temple, you got the right stuff. Go ahead and build it. Go ahead and do it. Go ahead and walk out the vision. Walk out the miracle. Walk out what he said. Walk out. Walk out. And watch God bring it to pass. Watch God turn it around. Watch God. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, it's my time. It's my time. You got the wrong neighbor. Find you somebody for the next 30 seconds and tell them, I waited too long. I waited too long. It's my time now. I got the right stuff. I've already been tested. I've already been tried. I came out with power. I came out with joy. It's my time. You got it. You got it. And it's going to happen in this location. It's going to happen. There are some things that God reserved for this address. There are some ministries that God reserved for this address. He gave it at the old address. But now was the time to build God a sanctuary. Well, Pastor, we already got a sanctuary. No, 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 no. He said, give me a place where I can dwell among them. I'm not just looking for a place to have church. He said, I want a place where I can dwell among them. Give your neighbor a high five and say, neighbor, he's coming to church. He's coming to church. Every time I'm coming to this location, to this address, I'm coming because he's going to meet us here. I don't care if it's an usher board meeting, he's going to meet us here. I don't care if it's choir rehearsal, he's going to meet us here. Why? Because it's our time. Why? Because we got the right stuff. How do you know? How do you know you have the right stuff? Because I never would have made it. That's how I made it through a wilderness. Because I had something in me that wouldn't make me quit. I felt like quitting. There's some of us in here, you recognize you wanted to throw in the towel and God wouldn't let you. Because he said, I put too much in you. Then there were, I'm done. But then there were others. We literally threw in the towel. I'm not. I ain't going. They can have it. I'm going to tell Pastor I'm through. But for some of us in here, you threw in the towel. And God threw it right back at you. Because he was saying, who do you think you are? This is going to sound rough for a moment. Who do you think you are? I have invested too much of me in you for you to throw in a towel. There's some people you're supposed to lay hands on. There's some people you're supposed to teach. There's some businesses that are supposed to start. But if you quit, you can't bless them. I gotta keep you moving. So I'm not accepting your resignation. Touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, God's not accepting your resignation. He said, the stuff that they had, it was sufficient. And then he said, it was too much. Now, from a biblical context, it was the stuff to build the sanctuary, the tabernacle. And the Bible says they restrained people from giving. We haven't made it there yet. Where we're telling people, we have enough volunteers, we have enough choir members, we have enough evangelists, we have enough, we're not there yet. There's still others that need to tell God yes, because the stuff you already have, it is not only sufficient, but he gave you an overflow. He said, it's too much. That's how much he blessed them coming out of bondage, to where the people had a mind to give, to sow what God blessed them with, because they recognized they didn't pay for it. When I remember, I don't pay for my anointing. I don't give God a certain amount of things and then he graces me with an anointing. No. It's his. If you read Paul's writing, Paul says they prophesy with the Spirit of God. They get gifts of helps by the same Spirit. Interpretation of tongues by the same.
It's his. And I can't tell him I don't feel like it. I can't tell him and be right in my argument. I don't want to, and I can't. And these are the reasons why. When God called Moses at 80 years old, the Bible says, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against Moses. Because Moses had a list of things as to why he could not do in his mind what God had called him to do. God already knew his limitations. I promise you, I'm done. I saw something online. Someone said, when God called you, he factored in our stupidity. He knew we wouldn't hit it right every time, and he called you anyway. He knew you wouldn't always step when he told you to step, and he called you anyway. He knew we wouldn't always fast when we're supposed to fast, and he called us anyway. Put his hand on us anyway. And if you know that God put his hand on you, and grace and mercy is abounding in your life because you recognize, if it had not been for the Lord who was on my side, lift those hands right where you are. Just lift them right where you are and just tell the Lord, thank you. Come on, tell him thank you. Tell him thank you. Tell him thank you. Tell him thank you. I'm submitted to his will. I'm submitted to his way. Have your way in my life. You got the right stuff. Stop trying to tell God what you can't do. He knows everything. That's why he wouldn't allow you to kill yourself. That's why he broke up the relationship. That's why things didn't happen the way you thought they should have happened, because he knows. Come on, lift your hands one more time. Lift your hands one more time. You've got the right stuff. God's been putting into this congregation for the last 10 years the right stuff for now. The right stuff for now to get us to the next phase and the next phase and the next phase. He does not give us more space so that we do less for him. He gives us more space so that we can maximize the space that he gives us. With my hands lifted, I just need to tell God yes one more time. Come on, open up your mouth and just tell him yes. Come on, tell him yes. Come on, tell him yes. Tell him yes. Tell him yes. Tell him yes. You've got the right stuff. Listen, if you're here under the sound of my voice and you're not saved, but you know you need to be saved. If you're here and you know you need to come to the Lord. This is your time. This is your time. This is your time. This is your time. If you desire your prayer, come. If you desire someone to touch and agree with you, come. Come. Come on. Come on. Do me a favor. Give God praise as they begin to walk down the aisle. Give God praise as they begin to come. Hallelujah. Come on. You can come. You can come. You can come. You can come. I'm not going to worry your patience longer than I already have. But if you desire to be saved, you desire to come, you desire your prayer, we want to touch and agree with you. We want to believe God with you. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Hiya. One more time. Yes, Lord. Someone needs to say that in their spirit. My life. My
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. There's still time for you if you're here and you want to come down. Hallelujah. One of the things that we're very grateful for at this assembly, we actually have a built-in baptismal pool. Amen. Built-in. Amen. And on last Sunday, we baptized 10 people. Was it 10 people? Baptized 10 people right here. Yeah. Hallelujah. That fits right in with the message. It gives you more so you can do more. It gives you more so you can do more. Hallelujah. Is there anybody else? As I said, we do have water if you recognize that you're not saved, and we do believe that you should repent and be baptized in the precious name of Jesus for the remission of your sins. That's why we believe that God gave his son, and the son gave his life. That's why we believe in baptizing in Jesus' name, and that you be raised in the newness of life. You're here and you're not saved, but you feel that tug. Maybe God is saying to you, make a change. Make a change, make a change. That old song used to continue, if I were you, I'd make a change. Hallelujah. Bless his holy name. Yes, Lord. Let's give God praise for this girl, Fair. And I mean, I think he was prepared to preach. It seemed like he was ready to preach. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we thank you. Amen. I believe, somebody help me, I believe that we do have refreshments in the fellowship hall. There are refreshments in the fellowship hall. So please go into our life center. Somebody will direct you to the fellowship hall after this service. And join us there. We're asking all the pastors to join us there. The members wanted to have a special table for you. So please join us. I'm going to ask Armor Bear Mike to come and get District Elder Fair and take him, let him, come get him. And let him refresh himself. Yeah, let him help. Now, if I want to thank you, altar workers, thank you. Please don't leave. We do want to lift an offering for the speaker. If you don't mind, we do want to lift the offering for the speaker. The deacons are here. Amen. We're asking you to be a blessing. Yeah. Asking you to be a blessing to him. Go give God praise for him and Bishop Gates. And Bishop Gates said and you heard him say he will come and he will be here back on Saturday. So he's in program to preach then. And so he will, the Lord will use him to be a blessing to us on Saturday as well. And we're looking for the District Elder Fair is back tomorrow night. Isn't that wonderful? Hallelujah. Now, I don't know if he preached tonight what he had planned to preach tomorrow night. But I know the Lord is going to give him something for tomorrow night. Because what he gave us tonight was for tonight. Amen. It was the right word. I'm so glad to know we got the right stuff.